Good afternoon. My name is Albert Park. I'm the director of the Institute for Emerging Market Studies here at HKUST, and we're very happy today to co-organize an event with the Asian Development Bank on the release of a new report on Asia's infrastructure needs, which ADB has just released today, and so you should be seeing articles in the media about this report. I think it got quite a lot of attention at a press release event this morning, also here in Hong Kong. Today, we have a number of distinguished guests from ADB here to help present the report, and then we have a couple of our distinguished faculty who will make some comments, and then we'll open it up for questions and answers. We are particularly interested in the infrastructure issues at our institute because we just got a new project on One Belt, One Road, and we know that One Belt, One Road is mainly focused on addressing infrastructure needs in Asia and beyond. So we will listen with great interest. One of our discussants is en route, so I'm told she'll definitely be here by the time she's supposed to speak, but she has seen the report, so hopefully there won't be anything too different in the presentation. Okay, so let me just welcome everybody, and particularly our guests from ADB. We hope that in the future there'll be opportunities for our institute to collaborate on studies and dissemination of ideas with the Asian Development Bank. So let me turn it over to Mr. Bambang Susantono. Is that right? Okay. The Vice President for Knowledge Management and Sustainable Development of the Asian Development Bank.
Thank you, Professor Park. Very glad.
Very good afternoon to all of you, distinguished colleagues, professors, colleagues from ADB, ladies and gentlemen. It is a great pleasure for us who is flying from Manila, come here, and then a sunny day here, good for us, not cold. And let me begin by thanking the Hong Kong University for Science and Technology, the Institute for Emerging Market Studies, for hosting today's seminar on our Asia infrastructure needs. This is the first knowledge event that we hold for this kind of, you know, disseminations of this report, and we choose this, you know, institutions because we are confident that you will be our knowledge partners that we can rely on, especially on disseminations and further discourse about this topic in the future. Earlier today, the Asian Development Bank launched this report. I believe that many of you has already have this one. The meeting is Asia Infrastructure Needs, and primary covering key infrastructure needs in terms of transport, power, telecommunications, water, as well as sanitations. These are key to economic development, as we all know, and also the poverty reductions. And more so as the dynamic of landscape of Asia and the Pacific continues to pose challenges and frame what we call a new normal for infrastructure development in the future to share and balance growth, right? So key challenge, we identify at least five. The first one is the rapid growth, right, of our member countries, especially those who are now already graduated to what we call the middle income status, leading to a shift toward knowledge-based economies. That's the first thing. Second one, the demographic changes due to the increasing lifespans leading to increase in aging population as well. The third one is the rapid urbanizations, leading to the development of megacities, metropolitan cities, as well as the new secondary cities that requiring paradigm shift in institutional decision-making for the improvement of livability. The fourth factor is rising inequality in income and opportunities since the early 1990s. And this one resulting in less inclusive growth. We all know that. And the fifth one is a significant increase in risk from climate change and natural disasters. So these are the five factors that we believe will shape the future of development in our regions in the Asia-Pacific. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, an impetus to addressing the challenge to this new normal and risk of climate change is provided by recent transformational global developments. These include the Sustainable Development Goals in September 2015, which responds to the challenges of conserving natural and human capital. And also we know that the Paris Agreement to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and limit global warming to 2 degrees Celsius. Indeed, the 17 UN Sustainable Development Goals, or SDG, acknowledge the important role of infrastructure that will have to play if the world is to achieve the 2030, the global agenda to end poverty, protect the planet, and ensure prosperity for all. Colleagues, in 2009, the Asian Development Bank launched a report titled The Infrastructure for a Seamless Asia. That was in 2009. And that report found that developing Asia needed to invest a little above 8 trillion between 2010 and 2020, or approximately, with a rounding up and stuff like that, is about 750 billion a year. We are now more than halfway into the 2010-2020 periods. And in the context of Asia dynamic growth, an update of Asia infrastructure needs is imperative. However, we know that infrastructure requirements in quantity and quality and financing merit a continued reassessment. By 2025, 60% of our global infrastructure investment will likely take place in Asia. And additional investment are required to ensure that public infrastructure delivers intended benefit under the likely impact of climate change. These have caused, on average, annual losses. This is one study that we cited, of about 73 billion of to infrastructure and other assets in the region over the past 10 years. Development banks like us will continue to play an important role in financing to this kind of infrastructure. So what has changed? First, when Seamless Asia in 2009 was written, the world was still in the midst of the global financial crisis. And there was much uncertainty as to how growth prospects would unfold. 8 years on, developing Asia negotiated through the global financial crisis and continues to grow robustly. And Asia infrastructure will need to keep pace with the new normal of continued expansion and dynamism. In this context, we in the Asian Development Bank has updated its projections of economic growth till 2030 and has sought to assess infrastructure needs that may to be required to support a more prosperous and livable Asia. Second, with concrete commitment to the 2015 Paris Agreement, where 195 countries have pledged to meet nationally determined contributions, there is an improved understanding and appreciation of the climate change impacts. And infrastructure has a key role to play in ensuring that these commitments are met. In particular, investing in efficient and cleaner power generations and electricity transmission, for example, has a critical role to play in climate mitigations. The IPCC, or the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, fifth assessment report, and our ADB Economic of Climate Change report depict unprecedented heat extremes, increasing frequency of intense storms and concentrated rainfall, sea level rise, and destruction of coral reefs. This also threatens the fishery-based livelihood with subsequent damage to agriculture. Such changes adversely impact human health and well-being disproportionately, affect on the poor, and threaten to the performance of vital public infrastructure. So our new estimates factor in most of these effects. So as my colleagues further will explain to you in greater detail, our estimated needs are more than double right now than the original 750 billion estimates. The continued rapid growth forecasted for the regions which generates new infrastructure demand and the inclusions of climate-related investment are the major contributing factors. So this leads to the inevitable questions: is Asia on track to meet this investment need? Okay, so the report estimates that the private finance requirement for developing Asia to meet its infrastructure needs and the increase in public sector investment through fiscal reforms. To preview a key result, the report finds that an almost 4 times increase in private investment in infrastructure will be needed. Furthermore, this step will not come without decisive policy actions by public sector in several areas. We can discuss more on this. This includes developing a regulatory environment that is conducive to private investment, including through public-private partnerships, deepening capital market, and building institutional and technical capacity for better planning and implementations of the projects. So can Asia economics carry out these policy actions and meet its infrastructure needs? Most view the ADB as just a bank that finances development projects. In fact, however, I would like to highlight that we in Asian Development Bank is also a knowledge bank. We strive to provide systematic, practical, and timely knowledge products to guide our member countries. We call it the Finance Plus Plus, when the first plus is the knowledge, and the second part is co-financing or cooperation with other development partners. And this special report is one of those important products, and in this context, your active participation is very important to all of us. We value your contribution to improving quality and relevance of our future knowledge product and services, and also improving our Asian Development Bank ADB operations. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I look forward to fruitful discussions, and thank you.
So I should have mentioned that Mr. Susantono is eminently qualified to address infrastructure issues. He was the former Vice Minister of Indonesia's Ministry of Transportation and Deputy Minister for Infrastructure and Regional Development there, and holds his PhD from UC Berkeley. Next, let me invite Dr. Juzhong Zhuang, who is ADB's Deputy Chief Economist of the Economic Research and Regional Cooperation Department. He has a PhD from Manchester and has a long and distinguished career at ADB, and has authored research papers and reports on a range of development issues in Asia, including related to growth, poverty and inequality, structural change, climate change, Chinese economy, et cetera. So welcome.
Thank you. Is this on? Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, let me join our Vice President to thank the Institute for hosting this event. We just had a media and press conference this morning to launch this report. So we are very happy, very pleased to come to the university and the institute to give a presentation to the academia, scholars here. So what I'm going to do is just, since the Vice President already explained some background why we are updating the figures, so I'll just go straight to this report. So this report, we have three objectives. The first is to look at how infrastructure conditions vary across countries. Certainly, region has invested a lot, but there are large variations across country in terms of infrastructure conditions. Second is to update ADB's estimates of infrastructure investment needs for the region, developing Asia, over the 15 years time from 2016 to 2030. So the last time the numbers were released in 2009. And then we briefly discussed the policy actions for how to meet infrastructure investment needs in the region. So that is the objective of the report. So let me just start with the key messages. Some of the messages the Vice President already mentioned. So basically, the developing Asia needs $26 trillion. This is in 2015 prices, or $1.7 trillion per year for infrastructure investment between 2016 and 2030, so 15 years time. But without climate change mitigation and adaptation, the needs are $22.5 trillion, or $1.5 trillion per year. Obviously, these figures are more than double ADB's 2009 estimates. And we also found that infrastructure investment gaps, because the gap is defined as the difference between the projected needs and the current investment. So projected needs and the current investment, that's the difference defined as a gap. The gap that varies across countries. So we looked at 25 countries with good data in 2016 and 2020. 5 years time, we have good reliable data. The gap is about 2.4% of the projected GDP. However, if we exclude China, this gap will rise to 5%, 5% of the projected GDP. So that 5% is quite significant. And we believe that both public and private sectors must increase infrastructure financing. And to achieve that, structural reforms are the key. So these are the key messages. So let's start just the first question, how much Asia is investing in infrastructure. So this chart shows the positive correlation between per capita GDP and infrastructure stock. So the horizontal is infrastructure stock, the index, and the vertical is per capita GDP. So we know that we all, you know, the research and infrastructure, so infrastructure played an important role as a key factor of production, the enabler of trade and investment, a driver of productivity growth, and of course the essential public services. So obviously you can find a close correlation, but of course this is a correlation, doesn't necessarily the causality, right? So we know that in economic, we try to establish causality is more difficult, but certainly we think it is a two-way causality from infrastructure to development outcomes and from development outcomes to infrastructure. So that's what I would frame that. Now, the region as a whole has invested quite significantly in infrastructure in the last 20, 30 years, especially in China, as we all know. And however, this both the quantity and quality of infrastructure still inadequate in larger parts of the region. This chart on the left-hand side, we show the electricity generation capacity for the developing Asia as a whole. The region actually invests quite a lot. From 2000 to 2012, the annual growth was 7.4% compared to OECD, only 1.9%. And for other developing countries, 1.1%. However, if you look at the country data, if you're at the level, so there's a large difference. For instance, in country Nepal, Cambodia, Bangladesh, or even India, the level of the electricity generation capacity per capita is only less than 10% of the OECD level. So it's quite startling, the difference, the level of per capita electricity generation capacity in the kilowatt per capita in 2012, for many countries, are less than 10% of the OECD level. Even for China, for instance, we know that China invests a lot. The level is only about less than half of the OECD level. So there are large gaps in terms of infrastructure provision. And on the right-hand side, we show that the transmission and distribution loss of the electricity. So for countries, for instance, Nepal, Cambodia, Myanmar, the 30%, up to 30% of industry, the electricity generated were lost in distribution and transmission. But on the other hand, we have a good performer like Malaysia and Korea and Singapore. So the loss much smaller. So basically, we want to show that there are large infrastructure investment that has been rapid in the region, but still there are large gap in both in terms of quantity and quality. So this chart, but of course, obviously the condition of infrastructure depend on the investment, right? So here we look at what is the country, the level of infrastructure investment as a percent of GDP, how these numbers look like. So we know that the infrastructure data are extremely difficult to collect. So normally you don't find the right statistics and, for instance, official data. So really you have to go into detailed budget data. And so here we use the government budget data on the infrastructure investment for the four sectors, the power, transport, telecommunication, water, and sanitation. So the four sectors is the government budget data plus the World Bank, there's a database called the Private Participation in Infrastructure Database. So provide cross-country the infrastructure projects the information, the private sector participate. So we put this together, we found that infrastructure investment varies significantly across countries. In Bangladesh, for instance, Mongolia, Pakistan is about 2% of GDP. On the other hand, we have the China and Bhutan, Vietnam. China is close to 7%. Vietnam, India, even also very high, more than 5%. So there's a large difference across countries. And also the private sector participation in infrastructure, this blown curve, also varies. For some countries, infrastructure is dominated by basically the government sector, the public sector, China, and Bhutan, and Mongolia, for instance. But on the other hand, the India, the 40% private sector financed, and Philippines, Pakistan, 50% private financed, and the Maldives, 80% private. So there are the large variations across countries. And this chart shows that some sectors are more attractive to private sector financing than others. So obviously, telecommunications are more attractive, are most attractive, actually. 3/4 of investment in 2011 was financed by private sector. Power sector is about a half, 50%. Transport, 20%. But water and sanitation predominantly the public sector. So now there are two criteria. Normally we look at why this the private sector versus public sector. You know, so one is the feasibility of the cost recovery. How easily you can impose user charges. If the easier you can do, then more private sector will come. Another is desirability. How desirable? Because some of the project. Public goods and externality, so you really, user charge may not be good from economic or social point of view. So that is what is tell here. The water and the sanitation certainly there's a strong externality, so that's why government dominant. But on the other hand, telecommunication is easier to have the user charge. Everybody uses a mobile phone, you pay the subscription, all these things. So that is the idea of that. I think that's underlying the behind the underlying economic reasoning. So the second part, we look at this. Basically, we assess infrastructure needs for the region for the 45 ADBs developing member countries and for the period of 2016-2030. Let me just talk about the methodology. Basically, we follow the same methodology as used by a 2009 study. It's a top-down approach. So we generate two sets of estimates. One is baseline estimates. It's based on empirical relationship between each type of infrastructure, for instance, kilowatts of electricity, or kilometers of roads, and this on the dependent variable, and the explanatory variables are economic and demographic factors, like GDP growth, per capita GDP, industry production share, and urbanization, urban population, that kind of variables. So, based on that kind of empirical relationship, we project the variables, explanatory variables for the future, and then we get the infrastructure stocks needed to support, for instance, certain level of GDP growth, and then we come out with the investment needs estimate. So this is broadly the idea based on the relationship between each type of infrastructure and economic and demographic factors. So that's baseline estimates. Now for the second set of is a climate adjusted estimates, we call. Basically, we take into consideration the investment needs for climate mitigation and adaptation. Adaptation here, we mainly focus on climate proofing. Basically make infrastructure more reliable and resilient. So that's the idea. So basically, climate adjusted estimates are the baseline estimates plus the investment needs for mitigation and adaptation. So mitigation, climate mitigation estimates need is basically we use the global energy model. The idea is that in order for Asia to contribute to meet the 2-degree global climate goal, we know that Paris Agreement has this global climate goal to limit the global mean temperature increase below 2 degrees from pre-industry level. So in order to achieve that goal, what Asia's contribution we have to do in terms of mitigation. So climate proofing basically on the basis of ADB's experience, we have done a lot of projects, what normally required a certain percent of the investment needs. So that's a plus add on to the baseline estimates. So this gives climate adjusted estimates. So that's the methodology. Now, so let me now turn to the results. Basically, this table presents both sets of the estimates, baseline and climate adjusted. As I said, climate adjusted is the baseline plus mitigation and adaptation needs, right? So let's look at the climate adjusted, let's look at the bottom two rows. For Asia and Pacific, there's 45 developing member countries of ADB. Under climate adjusted estimates, the total infrastructure investment needs will be $26 trillion from 2016 to 2030, right? That's the $26 trillion. That comes basically $1.7 trillion a year, and the equivalent to 5.9% of GDP. So 5.9% of GDP. On the other hand, and the baseline, because without climate mitigation adaptation, the total needs will be $22.5 trillion for the 15 years time, and that's $1.5 trillion a year, and it comes to 5.1% of GDP. So that is a broad number, the headline numbers, and then some newspapers have already been reporting. And then, of course, you can see from the more sub-regional data, there are the larger valuations. East Asia is the largest needs, dominated by China, obviously, and South Asia, Southeast Asia, and Central Asia, and the Pacific. But if you look at as a percent of GDP, interestingly, the Pacific has the highest number, 9.1% of GDP. So obviously, you know, Pacific, you know, there's a need, you know, they're vulnerable to climate change, and also more costly to build infrastructure. So that explains. And South Asia also the second, and then Central Asia, Southeast Asia, and East Asia. So that is the, I think that the key results I want to present. Okay, so this by sector, the power sector actually is the most has the largest needs. We're talking about $14.7 trillion over 15 years time, accounted for 53% of the total, and followed by transport. Transport here, we're talking about roads and railways, seaports and airports. Is 32%, $8.3 trillion. And telecommunication is about 9%, $2.3 trillion. And then we have water and sanitation, 3%, $800 billion. So this is a cross-section, the bisector, the needs, all in 2015 prices. Okay, now the third part, the last part of my presentation. Basically, here we want to look at how to meet infrastructure needs, how to close the infrastructure investment gaps. So here, because of the data limitation, we only focus on 25 developing member countries of ADB and with good data, and it's for the period of 2016 and 2020, in 5 years' time. So data are more reliable. We focus on that. So the first question is we ask is how big are the investment gaps for these 25 countries, right? And then we talk about how to finance these gaps. So the first row, we show that for the 25 countries I mentioned in 2015, the total infrastructure investment is $881 billion. And we know that, that for these 25 countries, the annual needs and the climate adjusted the scenario, annual needs is $1.34 trillion. So that means this gives up the gap of $459 billion, right? So this is equivalent to 2.4% of GDP. So if for the 25 countries here, that includes China, the gap is about 2.4% of GDP. On the other hand, if we close, take China out without China, 24 countries, the total, the estimated current investment in 2015 is close to $200 billion, $195. Annual needs is $500 billion, so this gives us the gap about $308 billion. So this will be 8 5% of GDP. 5% of GDP. So for China, we listed separately, the current investment in 2015 is $686 billion. And annually, according to us, I estimate is $837. So this gives a gap of $151 billion. Is equivalent of 1.2% of GDP. So obviously, in China, even though there are high level of investment infrastructure, there are still gaps out there because of the China is such a big country, and also in the urbanization, as well as the need to address climate change, developing renewable energy. So that's we still see this infrastructure investment gap compared to the current rate. Okay, so now the next question is how to bridge the gap. But here, as I said, China, even though the gap, gap is small compared to other countries, so we want to focus on the countries where the big the gap are most significant. So there's 24 countries, basically here, we exclude China for the period of 2016 to 2020. So for these 24 countries, the current investment in 2015 was $195 billion, as I said earlier in the previous table. So of which $63 billion by private sector, and the public is about $133 billion. So that is the current. Now, the approach is that we first figure out how much more the public sector can invest in infrastructure for these 24 countries. So because, you know, as we showed earlier, in Asia, still the majority of the infrastructure is driven by public sector, right? So we look at public sector, how much more they can come up with, you know, to increase infrastructure investment. So basically, we do this fiscal space analysis. We looked at the potential of increasing infrastructure investment through tax reform, increased tax revenue. One, right? And the second is the increased financing for infrastructure through spending reorientation. So for instance, the government can cut subsidy to the fuel subsidy, right? So many countries have fuel subsidy, so if that can be reduced, they can invest in infrastructure. Third is several countries can still have the room to borrow, public sector borrowing, bank loans or the bonds, right? So these are the sources we looked at, and we did a very detailed calculation. What do we find is that for these 24 countries, there is a potential to increase public spending on infrastructure by $121 billion annually for the period of 2016 to 2020. So this is public sector additional. Then the remaining, there's a difference between the total needs and the current investment and the additional public, the residual part, right, will be the private sector, right? So this is our approach. So we look at what's the gap, and then what's the additional public, and then the remaining part, the gap, remaining part of the gap will be for the private sector. That comes up with about $187 billion. And so that means the private sector investment in infrastructure we have to increase from currently $63 billion to $250 billion, right? An increase by $187 billion annually for the next 5 year period. Now the question, of course, whether this is achievable or not, so that is answer here. Basically, we believe that by and large, obviously, the region has a larger savings, and you know, so potentially can be achieved provided that we have a good policy actions. So the report will look at the three sets of policy actions. The first is fiscal reforms. As I mentioned, if your government wants to have additional spending on infrastructure, then we have to have tax reforms, for instance, introduce. So by and large, on average, developing Asia's tax revenue as a percent of GDP compared to the world, average is still low. So there is scope there to increase tax revenue. And for instance, you can introduce green tax, capital gain tax, property tax, that kind of tax, right? The second is spending reorientation to reduce subsidy, fewer subsidies, right? So that you can free up financing for that, and then borrowing. So as I mentioned, in addition to this, the government can also raise non-tax revenues. For instance, capture land value. So this is very common in China. So you have agricultural land, and then you can sell to the highest bidder, and then you get revenue. So that becomes the local government revenue, and then it can be used for infrastructure investment. And also user charges. User charges, you know, for some feasible or desirable, you know, some infrastructure, you can use user charges, and that provide additional financing. So that's the first. And the second set is to promote private participation. So basically, here we discuss the need to create a conducive investment climate and make great use of private-public partnerships. The PPPs is very coming in a big way, and many countries are promoting, and also international forum, for instance, G20 and APEC are promoting the great use of PPP. And then the deepening capital markets is important, especially the bond markets. So third set of reform is actually is we need a better planning and design execution. So we need to have a pipeline of bankable projects so that the private sector can come in, and of course as well as the public sector, right? So not just financing, not just you know, the things discussed, but we need better planning, and we need the design and execution of the project. This is very important. For some countries, this is a big constraint. So let me just finally, I don't know, time is running out. Just give me 2 minutes, role of MDBs. The ADB is a multilateral development bank in developing Asia. There's the World Bank, for instance, there's also Islamic Development Bank, and then now we have AIIB. So certainly, we see MDB infrastructure financing important. In 2015, it's about 2.5% of total current investment. That is a number, 2.5%, but the number is small. However, if we exclude China and India, the MDB share increased to more than 10%. So 10% is quite significant. And so we consider for ADB that our financing will increase. We are scaling up our annual loan and grant approvals from $17.5 billion in 2016 to more than $20 billion by 2020. And a growing share of our loans will go to the private sector. So for MDB, the financing is limited. However, we are not just providing financing, but we are blending our financing with expertise and cross-country knowledge. We support the policy reforms, and we promote regional cooperation. So our value added far beyond just simple financing. We have a vice president said, in the knowledge, where ADB is not, we try to become a knowledge bank. So that's the last slides. That's just a repeat of the key messages. So I will stop from here. Thank you.
So we've asked two of the faculty associates of our institute to provide some comments on the report. And we've budgeted 15 minutes for the discussion comments, so maybe about 7.5 minutes each as a target. And since we're running behind schedule, I want to just forewarn everyone we'll extend the time of this session by 15 minutes and try to plan to close it around 5:15. Okay. So David Cook is a professor in the economics department. He's an international macroeconomist who's very familiar, I know, with many of the countries in Asia. So he's going to speak first.
Okay, so thank you to the organizer for inviting me to discuss this very interesting paper, and to the authors and the team at the ADB for providing a very very interesting perspective on the future infrastructure needs. And what I'm going to try to do is just quickly summarize my reading of the paper before walking into the presentation, and then taking a slightly different viewpoint of the region's infrastructure needs, emphasizing more macroeconomic data rather than the sectoral microeconomic data provided by the banks. Okay, so let's see. So I guess maybe to try to summarize what I read in this report is that, basically speaking, developing Asian economies have good infrastructure compared to other developing economies, maybe even slightly better along a different range of qualitative measures. But it's a very high growth area of the world. The economies here are growing relatively quickly, and the population is really large, so the infrastructure financing needs are also going to be large. And that maybe when we think about the aggregate level of investment that we need to engage in here, that this might run into some sort of bottleneck, especially in the financing part of this investment. So what they do is go sector by sector, measure each country's infrastructure needs, then aggregate all of those up together to the country level, and then aggregate again to the regional level to get some idea of the massive sort of investment that needs to be undertaken. And then we try to compare that with some sort of financing capacity that we have which suggests that we do need some particular role for policy facilitation to really finance all of that infrastructure investment. Okay, and so my reading of this is that they make a pretty good case for this point of view. And when you delve into the details and all the various appendixes and footnotes, that they provide a range of evidence based on first-rate macroeconomic, microeconomic, and econometric analysis of various data sources. So they really dig into the best data that's available to try to build a case for this. And then beyond that, the reading the paper is quite rewarding in that it's a real catalog of all the different issues related to infrastructure investment in the region that you can go into sort of scientific and engineering difficulties. There's a close look at fiscal policy and the financial sector and how all of those play in together into a reading of the current situation. So I wouldn't hesitate to recommend that somebody who was beginning an analysis of infrastructure investment, especially in the Asian region, to go to this as a first stop, because you can really see different issues, different data sources, the different perspectives of urban and development economics, as well as all of these other economic issues. So I think all of that is quite to the good. Now, as I said, that basically they're building their case for massive aggregate infrastructure investment spending needs from a sectoral point of view. So they go sector by sector to see what are going to be the investment needs. So basically it's building up from the microeconomic evidence and aggregating at several steps to build a kind of idea about what is the about what the infrastructure investment needs. So I decided to reverse direction. I'm a macro person, so I thought, well, what sort of evidence can we build from just looking at the macroeconomic data? What sort of insights does that bring? And so to get a simple sort of sufficient statistic to analyzing these issues, what I did was use neoclassical growth theory to construct an estimate of the returns to capital investment in the different macro economies in the region. And so I made a different a set of different assumptions here based on that macroeconomic analysis. But essentially, what we're doing is just comparing the accumulated investment that we have in the different categories with the production that's resulted, and using that to infer what is the returns that we are getting from capital in different countries of the region. And so these are just a picture of what I get when I apply this to the U.S. and Japan, measured in terms of percentage returns to investment. So this we can think of it in some sort of financial sense that will allow us to compare across countries. And this just validates it, that it seems to get reasonable results for returns to private capital, relative returns to public investment of capital. What we see looking at the U.S. and Japan is maybe that these are relatively reasonable estimates of what these are. Maybe the returns to capital in Japan are relatively low, and the returns to public capital in the U.S. are maybe relatively high, which is consistent with some people's investment our assessment of the situation in the U.S. that maybe we have relatively high infrastructure needs. Now, I would say that there is a difference that the report emphasizes a difference between public capital, which is government investment, and infrastructure investment, but there's a strong correlation across countries in these measures. So I'm going to just use this as my simple measure of these. So then let's look at the returns to public capital and try to make these comparisons about what are the returns. So we see that in developing economies globally, this tends to average something about 12%, but in recent periods has been trending downward. And then emerging markets, we have which is kind of a middle income economy assessment. This is relatively higher. It stays relatively stable. Advanced economies have the highest returns to public investment. And then what we see is that if we look at basically the ADB member countries that I could assess in East, South, Central, Southeast Asia, we see that it's somewhere in between here, between that of developing economies and global emerging markets. So it seems pretty stable. And what we see is it tends to be something about 10 or 11% in the current issue, and not really a standout amongst the world's regions, indicating that maybe we have a pretty well developed infrastructure in global comparison when we compare with global economies. If we try to compare this, to break these down in terms of returns to possible investment in the public sector, in the private sector, in the relevant Asian economies, what we tend to see is that when we look at emerging markets, here, again, we have pretty high returns to public capital, so that there does seem to be a case for investing in government investment in the region. And when we compare it to the returns to private capital in the region, it does tend to be relatively advantageous amongst the middle income economies. Okay, and then maybe when we look at developing economies, maybe what we see when we look at this, the developing economies of the various relevant Asian economies, this tends to be pretty low. The level of public capital relative to the size of the economies is already pretty large in these economies, tends to be low on a global state perspective. What we see is that in the beginning of about 25 years ago, private investment had high returns because many of these economies are transition economies, so their private investment was relatively undeveloped. This has somewhat converged in the more recent period, but we still see that roughly speaking, private capital investment may be more important or offer higher returns, at least in developing economies. Okay, so maybe what we could do is then break this down into various country levels. One of the interesting things that we see that when we look at variation amongst the developing Asian economies is that we do tend to see a pretty good correlation, a positive correlation between returns to investment in public and private capital amongst developing economies. That is, countries that have high returns to public investment also have high returns to private investment. To me, this means that in these countries in which there are relatively high returns after this long stage, is that there may be some sort of financing problems in all types of investment that may need to be overcome to achieve the greatest level of efficiency. And then what we see is that, not breaking naming the countries in particular, but what we see is that when we look at the middle income economies in the region, that we see the reverse correlation, in which countries that have high returns to public capital also will tend to have relatively lower returns to private capital, indicating that within these economies that there may be some sort of trade-off that's being made in allocating the capital and thinking about how those trade-offs might be balanced is going to be the issue for the middle-income economies. And maybe this is why we see that the returns to public capital still remain relatively high in the middle income economies, perhaps because of this allocation trade-off. And then so just in conclusion, when we look at the stability to the returns to investment in public capital, that indicates to me that we're roughly speaking on our balanced growth path when it comes to public investment. That is to say, given that we've stabilized this, it's not likely that further public investment is going to be a particular engine of growth. So what we see is that what we're likely to see in the future is balanced growth in infrastructure spending, which is to say infrastructure spending needs to keep up with the future growth path of these economies. And given that this growth is likely to be large, then it is likely that this infrastructure investment is likely to also need to be large. And then I just summarize what I said before, is that maybe macro level finance is particularly important in developing economies. Allocation issues are more important in middle income economies, allocation between public and private capital. And so that's I think it's basically I think supports the case that is made by this report for thinking about large needs for infrastructure investment, and also maybe give some bird's eye view of what the issues are likely to be in different countries at different stages of development. Thank you.
It seems like David should write his own report, and we could have an annex or something. But he's putting some emphasis, I think, more on thinking about investment as a facilitator of growth. I think the ADB report is more trying to think of it as a correlate of growth to just get a general sense about what are the projected levels. So the next discussant is Alicia Garcia Herrero, who is an adjunct faculty in our economics department in the business school and also chief economist for the Asia Pacific at Natixis, which is a boutique investment bank, French investment bank here in Hong Kong. And she is also has affiliations with Bruegel in Europe and is working with our institute on our One Belt, One Road project. So Alicia.
Well, yeah, my voice is, can you hear me?
Yes,
Yeah, okay, that's great. So thanks very much. It's really a wonderful report. I was very impressed by the appendixes. I saw all of these potential changes in, you know, especially fiscal reform, and I just found that the amount of work you've actually done here is very impressive. As Albert said, I work, you know, I have like two hats, so a few of the comments will be more academic, not as much as David, but, you know, a few. But the others will really focus on my work. Actually, Natixis does lend a lot infrastructure, and I learned there why probably your figures will never be achieved. And let me literally go through the rationale behind. And I wonder whether it's a bad thing after all, so I'll get there. So on the first hat, like researcher hat, I'd like to start with the fact that beyond the tax issues that you mentioned, what really impressed me was your measurement of the capital stock. I mean, this is the capital stock in as far as it's related to the infrastructure sectors that you have compiled, and you could go about why some are not there and why, you know, which would be a big discussion. But for what you focused on, I was very impressed by, you know, the actual estimate of that, which is of course a huge issue for such report. But having said that, in a way that's very difficult, but in a way it's the past, or, you know, the present as much. The real question when you look at forecasting or trying to assess what will be the infrastructure needs of the region is really a global issue. I mean, what kind of infrastructure will we need? So you have there like telephone lines, for example. Well, you know, I wonder how many will we need? Or, you know, so basically what I'm trying to say is that there is a lot of what the report argues we need that I'm not sure we will need. And I do acknowledge that you go into that direction when you offer two measures of infrastructure needs, one which would be like the baseline, and the second, which for me is probably the baseline, which is what if you take into account of climate change. And so I was wondering whether you could dwell into that for literally everything you do, because, you know, what if due to technological change in every single sector, we need something else, or this. So there's a lot of issues there that I think could be exploited, because you do have a lot of data, and beyond climate change. So, you know, digital economy, blah blah blah. I think that would be that, because you are forecasting at the end of the day. So no matter how good your work is in estimating the stock of capital, it's just always kind of a, you know, you're just pushing it forward. And I think, you know, given what you're talking about, this 20 plus trillion US dollar, people will wonder, do we really need that? So, and moving from hard infrastructure to soft infrastructure, all of those discussions that we all know about. So that would be perhaps second comment. Then just a minor thing. I mean, when we talk about upgrading these countries to a certain infrastructure level, and the answer might be in the report, but I couldn't find it. I wonder whether you're trying to put all of them to a certain level, or you're putting all of them at the level they should be given their income per capita. I guess the second, because otherwise the China numbers look to me very big, but I'm not sure. I just couldn't figure that out. So that's a question, open question. Because ideally it would be the second thing you would need to do. I mean, it's not that you want to upgrade the poorest country on earth to, you know, the highest level, but actually follow what should be their pattern for a certain income per capita. So I moved to my second hat, which is that of, you know, I'm not a banker, but I help banks take decisions. And when I see those numbers and your trade-off, or your, you know, public versus private, what's the role of the private sector in all of this? I would argue that in the current circumstances, given the numbers you showed, and I'll offer you a few numbers that I use for a project I'm working on the financing of the Belt and Road, they just look humongous. Just to give you a sense of dimension, total cross-border lending because banks, as of today, play a big role. We can say, you know, ADB is of course great, AIB, all of that, but as you showed already, these are very small numbers. You can say these are catalyzers, but they can't really play that role. So I checked AIB current, you know, already like disbursements, or not disbursements, indeed, disbursements of the projects they have announced is 1.7 billion. Look at the needs, it's just impossible. So certainly think about regional development banks as catalyzers. Then you move to banks. Banks, you first start with the local banks, with domestic banks. So take the case of China. In the case of China, you have these huge development banks, which we all know, $1 trillion. China Development Bank balance sheet, probably the biggest in the world. So it's not the biggest, but among. So that is humongous. So how much of that can be deployed for infrastructure? And the question is domestically versus cross-border, because a lot of the projects are actually cross-border. So you look at then, I want to focus on cross-border because that's the hardest part actually. Because tax base might not help and, you know, a lot of other things might not be shared in a way. So if you look at that, that's why I start looking at cross-border lending. So the world as such lends about $3 to $4 trillion. This is the stock of lending, not even the flow, to the developing world. And you're talking 20, you know, it's like just, and this is everything, this is trade finance. So I just feel that can't be solved through banks, no matter how big. So we need to move to capital markets, and then there, of course, there's no way, as of today, that can be financed in the current, you know, with the current size of capital markets in Asia. There's two things I think one could think of doing. One is, of course, pension reform. So you think about Australia, superannuation funds, I mean, the role in infrastructure investment. I think that could be one of the private-public type reforms beyond tax reform that I think countries could engage into to deepen the capital markets and the part related to infrastructure, because you need long-term investors for this. The other thing is to make originate to distribute more of a model in Asia. India and China, of course, are not yet in this, you know, they feel they have enough big banks, domestic big banks to do this. But the question is, how much can we engage in a discussion? Yes, maybe now, but not for the next 20 years. We need leaner balance sheets. We need institutional investors. This goes back to the pension reform I was mentioning, to take part of this burden. And then the distinction between public and private becomes blurred, because you don't actually need a fully private pension regime to do this. So I just wanted to kind of dwell a little more on the financing part and on the fact that maybe even fiscal reform alone, because these countries, as they become more mature, it's not only infrastructure they will need. It's education, health, you know. Part of them will be aging. So I just feel that it's more than that we need, and that there will not be enough fiscal space. So we have to think beyond that. And I think we need to think about institutional investment, pension reform in particular, trying to bridge the gap to finance long-term projects, especially infrastructure. So that would be all from my side. Thank you.
Okay. Maybe we can open up to the audience for questions before we come back to the ADB group. So are there any other comments from other people? So while you're...
I'm Xun Wu with the Institute for Public Policy at UST here. I have a question about the treatment of the state-owned enterprises and in your division of a public versus private. The reason I'm asking this question is that because a couple of years ago, the Chinese government had made a decision to make the public owned enterprises eligible for PPP deal as a private sector partner, right? So a lot of these are also listed companies, but majority owned by the government. So I wonder, in your calculation, on how do you deal with this rising importance of state-owned enterprises and their investment?
Let's collect. Are there any other hands up right now? Yeah.
In infrastructure.
Okay, great.
Yeah,
are you done?
Yeah. Yeah.
So let me add a question of my own. One thing that kind of puzzled me about the very large gaps you're estimating is that the basic forecasting equation that you're estimating is just based on historical data, on demographics and GDP per capita, et cetera. And so you're fitting the projections for the future to the past, which suggests that as long as people are doing what they've been doing in the past, the investment should be just about right, because that's what you're fitting it to. But then I realize when you estimate the investment infrastructure needs, you apply these coefficients from ADB project estimates about the cost of a kilometer of road, et cetera, and maybe those costs are just making it much more expensive than what was actually spent in the past to achieve the same infrastructure development. So, as an exercise, what you could do is you could take your methodology about pricing these things and go back to the historic data and said, how much would they have needed to achieve the infrastructure growth that you witnessed in the past, compare it with the same budget data in the past for how much they actually spent, and probably it might be actually way overestimated, which suggests that to build, you're thinking about these shiny new ADB roads, but the actual roads maybe are some pretty poor, you know, much more low-cost roads, and maybe some kind of calibration in that way would get you to a lower estimate of the gap, because the gaps are so daunting. It seems like it almost seems like you're going to make every country feel terrible that they're so far from their goals. So maybe there's some way to have some robustness to scenarios where you price the infrastructure more cheaply. So that's just a comment. Any other comments? Okay, let me allow then the Juzhong, do you want to start? And
yeah,
I think other colleagues at AB can jump in as well.
I'll ask my colleague to get into more detailed.
I think the methodology, Albert already, you also explained. Basically, we look, we use historical data to estimate the empirical relationship and then project the future trends of the explanatory variables and apply into the model and generate demand, the investment needs. So that's the methodology. And to some extent, your question about this infrastructure need will continue to increase. Actually, we use some kind of non-linear. You know? So for instance, country become income continues to increase, actually run, right? There's a variable that as a share of the GDP, infrastructure needs will decline, right? The model that there's a square term there.
I mean, we experimented with.
Okay. And like I said, maybe you can give us some more details. On the question about, SOE, so I think in the case of China, we treated SOE as a public, right?
Yeah.
So that's why China, the figure, you know, show the private sector is very small, because we consider SOEs or the public sector. The question about why SOE, the private sector investment is so low, because in China, we know that the infrastructure, public utilities, are considered as strategic industries for the government. And then in the past, it has been the public sector dominant. But in the future, I think the government now is promoting PPP. But if the SOE is considered as PPP, then so perhaps SOE is still SOE. So, but by and large, I think the role of the private sector probably will increase over time, but probably will be slow because infrastructure is tend to be very big and considered a strategic industry. So the public goods, basic services, so that's government policy. Yeah.
And the numbers are too big, but if you look at it as a percent of GDP, is climate change adjusted figures only 5.9%. 5.9%. Without climate change, it's 5.2%. So if you look at the case of Philippines, for instance, the government target is medium-term target is to Philippines, no? Increase infrastructure investment to 7.5% of GDP. So, and Indonesia, I think, is 5 to 6% of GDP. India already 5.4% of GDP. So, in that sense, it's not that it's within the range, and so I would think that way. So then, Rana, you want to give some more specific details on the modeling and the methodology? Yeah.
Thank you. So a couple of points. So first of all, Albert, your point, I should first thank our both our discussants for a very thoughtful set of comments and analysis, actually. Now, starting with the last point that's been raised about the numbers, so you're right. The unit costs that we're using, we do use ADB projects, and ADB projects do tend to, you know, there's more attention being paid to safeguard issues, environmental audits, etc. But in some sense, it's something you do want to do, actually. So one could argue that it's more expensive, but on the other hand, it's also something that you would want to do. We thought about investment needs from another perspective. You're right. I mean, essentially, we've taken the relationship of the past, extrapolated to the future. But another thing one can do is say, okay, look, we take China. China is the one economy which has really invested a lot, and we say, okay. If you look at the infrastructure services that you know, the average Chinese citizen enjoys, and compared to what the average OECD country citizen enjoys, what's the gap? So we worked this out, and it's huge. You know, just some examples are, if you look at urban water sewerage pipes, China's numbers are controlling for population, of course. It's only 17% of what's there in Japan. Sanitation, again, just 18%. Roads, Zhuang has done these calculations very carefully. He's looked at adjusting for the quality of roads, and you find that in the case of roads, Zhuang would be required to actually bring things to that quality level of OECD, and you use actually the Chinese numbers for road construction, not even the OECD numbers, so even using those. Power sector, China is at 46% of the average OECD economy in terms of you know, just the availability of power, kilowatts of energy. So when we looked at this other way of doing things, we found, you know, this is actually considerably less. And what it's doing is, it's basically, we're starting off with a set of very simple growth projections, really. There's a convergence factor built in, and then we're looking at this past relationship. So to that extent, the point you raised is right, that if in the future you're going to be able to deliver all these things much cheaper or in different ways, then yes. And that's an exercise, we do want to think about, and that's where engaging with academia and just how do you model that? How do you model these disruptive technologies? In fact, with the VP, we've been discussing precisely this issue. How is that going to affect things? We would love to think about taking that into account and really work with you on things like that. I'm losing track of the issues. Zhuang, did you, something on the SOEs?
I just add a little bit of a detail on these measurement issues, also related to the questions. So the first one on the SOEs, So for a number of Asian countries, we do not have good data on SOE's measurements. But for three large economies, we do have a very comprehensive measure. So the first one is for China. So for China, the Statistics Bureau provides comprehensive data that covers investments by governments, SOEs, and private enterprises. Our difficulty is we cannot break down the investments by SOEs and governments and private for China. But we do have the total number of investments. And then that's related to the second question, how do we infer the private? So we have the total investments for the China, and then for the private, we take the World Bank database on private investments. That's project level database. So we just aggregate the numbers to get the private investment. So the issue with this approach is that database by the World Bank does not cover 100% of the private investments. So in some sense, when you look at China, the private is very small. That partly could be because some private investments is not included. So in that sense, it's a lower bound estimate. Of course, for Indonesia and for India, we have a very detailed information on the investment by different investment parties. So for these three countries, we are very confident that the measurements of SOEs and privates are included. And I think the last question of the question raised by Albert. So we try everything in this report. At the beginning of our exercise, we try exactly this approach you suggest. We take the historical physical data, for example, the length of the kilometers of a road, okay, and then apply our unit cost and see whether we can match the numbers, the physical road length and the values. But we found there are a lot of data issues. For example, you look at the roads, the kilometers of roads, that's a stock. In order to do that calculation, we need the flow of the road, the changes. And then the quality of information is not good. For example, you look at some countries, like the length of roads actually could change over time. Because when the Statistics Bureau report the thing, they're reporting the actual use of roads, how many kilometers of roads are in use. Right, so it could actually increase because we don't really know what's the actual change. So these are small things, but we did try, and in the future we'll try to get a better quality of data, try to improve our estimates, because we do this report in a very limited time, so there's a lot of scope for improvement.
Right.
Thank you. I'll just make a few points, largely in agreement with Professor Herrera, with regarding to the need to catalyze private sector finance. I think the report is very clear that there's a huge residual that needs to be filled up from the private sector. As we know, Asia has been largely bank-focused. And a couple of numbers I can give you to give you perspective. In Asian economies, I think banks provide 40% of the total debt. Versus in the US, it's about 70%. Or the other way around. In Asian countries, banks provide 70% of total debt, versus developed countries, more like 40%. So in developed countries, more debt comes from the capital markets also. As you know, a lot of economies are moving towards Basel III, which makes it even more difficult to come by bank financing. Experts tell us that as a result of Basel III, there'll be a 2 to 5% increase in the funding cost for banks. And that translates into a 5% reduction in the return of equity on projects. So that makes it even more difficult or less attractive for projects to attract banks. Banks can do two things. They can either reduce their exposure, or they can go towards most risky projects in search for yield, both of which are not very good. So therefore, the message clearly is that the future lies in the capital markets, not in banks. Now, with regard to capital markets, most of the capital market, debt markets in Asia are more nascent, exception being Malaysia, which can even support greenfield infrastructure projects through the bond market. And that's because there's been a huge government focus on getting a lot of the enabling environment of the bond markets right. Other Asian economies have a long way to go. India, my country, there is very little liquidity in bond markets for ratings below A. And that is basically beyond the pale of most infrastructure projects. So, but there is huge potential. You mentioned the need for pension insurance funds. There's a huge market out there of pension insurance funds, and very frankly, it is the liability structure of pension insurance funds that makes it particularly conducive for project finance. Most investors in the bond markets are bullet investors. However, insurance pension funds, they look for more stable long-term income streams. So that makes a happy match. The problem with institutional investors, like insurance funds and pension funds, is when they invest in the bond market, they have very little control of the project. Banks have more immediate control of the project through the covenants that they are able to enforce in the financing agreement. Bond market investors are far removed. A fund sitting in California has no clue what's happening in a Philippine project or a Malaysia project or a project in India. So every last aspect of risk needs to be covered by the fund manager to take comfort in the fact that the investment is safe. And that needs a huge governance, regulatory, and a legal system that needs to be able to support the financing. So I fully take your point that it is a very complex issue. Another point is that, you know, if you want to bring international investors in, international investors typically look for minimum A-rated paper. That needs a huge amount of credit enhancement, given the kind of quality of underlying projects. The ADB can, there are institutions within ADB like the Credit Guarantee Investment Fund, which can precisely design to play this kind of a role to provide this level of enhancement. But all this brings me to the bottom line that money is there, but getting the money in is extremely complex. So there's a huge ecosystem that needs to be put into place to be able to support the financing needs.
Thank you for those very useful comments. So let me just introduce our last speaker. This is Mr. Vivek Rao. Yes, and then earlier was Rana Hasan, who's the lead on the report, and all from, and Juzhong was an old friend, Juzhong Liu, who's also works in the same division, right, at the ADB. Since we're over time, let me close the event and thank all of the participants, our guests from ADB, and all of the discussants and the participants. Thank you.